Welcome everybody to the Liturgy of the Chalice. I'm so excited you're here with me. Today we begin a new series of talks for the next several months or so. And we're going to be talking about the Gospel of Mark. The Gospel of Mark is the oldest of the four canonical Gospels accepted by Orthodox churches. And those four canonical Gospels are Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. The Gospel of Mark was written after Paul wrote the authentic Pauline epistles. Paul met with the pillars of the Jerusalem assembly, James, Peter, and John. And as you might read from the Pauline epistles, they became his avowed enemies. So those men and women who actually studied with the living Jesus, that actually heard him speak, that were authorized by him to teach his message to the world, Paul disagreed with them and said, "Oh, they're doing wrong things. Do it my way, this way that I have received through these revelations." So Paul never met Jesus in the flesh. He never knew him. He never received teachings from him. In some places, Paul said he never met James, Peter, or John. In other places, he said he did. And there's a high likelihood that Paul did meet with them or the disciples of the apostles, because Paul did have some historical teachings of Jesus in his writings, to which he added his own Christology or his own dogma and doctrine. So Paul created Christianity. There's no doubt about it. Paul created Christianity, which is very different from what the historical Jesus would have taught. So to the right here, you see a listing of the different documents of the early church, the authentic letters of Paul, followed by Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. And you see the approximated dates of release according to biblical scholarship. Paul makes no mention of the events described in Mark or subsequent gospel accounts, yet all the gospels borrow Pauline Christology. So that's interesting to note. Even though in Mark itself, as we'll discover down the road, Jesus says that he doesn't subscribe or believe in a Messiah ben David, you find throughout the canonical Gospels Jesus being described as the son of David, despite his protest in Mark itself. And this is from Pauline belief structure, from the Pauline Christology. Paul had a different messianic expectation than Jesus did. Paul was teaching that Jesus was the Messiah ben David who would come down from the clouds, which would unleash judgment day, so on and so forth, and there would be this rapture of souls up into heaven. That was Paul's belief, according to different mystical revelations that he said he achieved. But Jesus did not speak of those revelations. In fact, in Mark, he said that he didn't believe in a Messiah ben David, but he did propose the Son of Man Messiah. And the Son of Man Messiah, whenever you read the Judaic scriptures, the writings, the Talmud, whenever you examine the book of Enoch, 1 Enoch, you see that the Son of Man Messiah is a corporate or a collective Messiah of purified souls or saints. So Jesus taught about the Son of Man Messiah, which is basically the communion of saints, and Paul taught about Jesus being the Messiah ben David, which goes against Jesus' probable historical teachings themselves. So it is interesting because Paul doesn't talk about a virgin birth. I mean, that seems like it's pretty hard to miss, right? Paul doesn't talk about any of the childhood antics or meeting the devil in the desert. He doesn't talk about any of the exorcisms or healings, all these amazing things that we find in the canonical Gospels. He doesn't talk about any miracles as described in the Gospel of John. He doesn't refer to any of Jesus' famous parables. So in short, Paul really did not know any of the probable historical teachings of Jesus. He had a mystical experience that he believed was Jesus coming to him, telling him to teach these things. And through a series of different revelations and different types of channeling, which is called Holy Spirit channeling, is what we call it. But it's described in Corinthians quite clearly that there were people that could speak in tongues, and there were people that interpreted tongues. And the people that spoke in tongues were receiving teachings from the Holy Spirit or from angels. And they would start talking in unintelligible tongues, and then an interpreter would say, oh, this is what the Holy Spirit is saying. And that's how Pauline Christology and modern dogma and doctrine of the Orthodox Christianity of modern day, that's what Christianity is. It's the teachings of Paul. It's Paul's religion, which became known as Christianity. But in many cases, what Paul taught, which greatly influenced the canonical Gospels, had no basis in the historical teachings of Jesus, because Paul didn't know the historical teachings of Jesus. All four canonical Gospels were written by Greek-speaking writers who often misunderstood the Aramaic Hebrew teachings of Jesus, or understood them partially in out-of-context ways because they did not understand the profound depths of Judaism and Kabbalistic thought, which framed and informed Jesus' teachings, which is known as Halakha. The problem with modern Orthodox Christianity is that until recently, or relatively recently, in the last 50 to 100 years, most scholars were associated with a Christian denomination and were paid by them to write about the dogmas and doctrines that a particular church sect and their authorities believed in, or wanted others, the lay people, to believe in. They taught that the Bible was perfect, unadulterated truth. This is God's word. However, this is not true. When people say that the Bible is perfect truth and there's nothing incorrect about it, it's historical fact, that is called biblical literalism. You're taking everything literal. However, biblical scholarship, contemporary biblical scholarship, looks at the probable environment of Jesus, which was the environment of Judaism. Jesus was a Jew, and all of his teachings would have been grounded and rooted in the Hebrew Bible, right? The Hebrew Testament. And those beliefs would have been Jesus' beliefs. So we have to understand Jesus' teachings as we see them through the eyes of the canonical gospel. We have to understand them through a Jewish lens. And also, biblical scholarship also looks into the area of Gnosticism, to look at how different Christian Gnostic sects, how they approached these gospels, how they understood them. Despite what the Catholic Church wants you to believe, there wasn't just one church in the beginning. There were many, many churches after the crucifixion event. And they all believed in different things, held different doctrines, had different worships, different methods of meditation, even things that would look magical to some. So the Bible was inspired by God and people's postulations about God, but it wasn't written by God. So it's not perfect. And in the case of the Christian Testament, there are vast misunderstandings about Jesus' teachings because they were written by Greek writers who were not Jewish and did not understand Jewish customs, idioms, nor did they understand Aramaic or Hebrew to a great extent. So it's like the Tower of Babel repeats itself, right? Everybody goes into the Tower of Babel and everybody's running around. They can't understand each other because they're all speaking different languages, right? They're speaking in tongues. It's really an apt metaphor for what happened to Jesus' teachings as it was translated into the canonical Gospels. Due to this fundamental language and cultural barrier, Jesus' teachings have become almost unrecognizable in many sections of the Gospels written about him. Jesus and his disciples traveled to spread his teachings. Likely at that point in antiquity, the apostles were illiterate, as they were mostly drawn from the fishing class. So in the time that Jesus would have been walking the earth, 99% of the world was illiterate. Only 1% could read and write. And notice that the core of Jesus' disciples, they were all fishermen. So it's highly likely that they were illiterate. Which debunks the whole idea that the Catholic Church taught, at least when I was a kid. I think they're finally getting out of this stage. But a lot of the times they'd say, oh, John really wrote the Gospel of John. Mark really wrote the Gospel of Mark. Luke really wrote the Gospel of Luke. And it's not true. These Gospels were written over a long period of time, as we already showed in an earlier slide. So all of Jesus' teachings originally were passed by word of mouth, which became known as the Q Gospel. And this isn't a gospel that we can hold in our hands and read in a book. I mean, some authors have tried to reproduce Q, but Q is extinct. Q, hypothetically, is whenever a disciple would hear something and they would remember it. And then after a few generations passed, these stories were circulating throughout Judea in the area about Jesus and his teachings. And eventually somebody decided to write them down, which became maybe journals of teachings, which then evolved into the four canonical Gospels and other Gospels that are not accepted by Orthodoxy, but in many cases are quite historical. Pauline churches grew fast and ultimately covered and obscured the original teachings of Jesus as taught by James, the biological brother of Jesus and Jesus' successor, who led the Jerusalem assembly. So, and it's only natural to understand why this happened. James the Just, who was the bishop of the Jerusalem assembly and probably all of Christendom, or what would become called Christianity, he taught what could be called Jewish Christianity because Jesus was a Jew. And they just happened, the disciples of Jesus happened to be Jews that followed the specific teachings of their Jewish teacher, Jesus. But in order to become a Jewish Christian of the original Jerusalem assembly, you had to do Torah. So you had to do all the observances and commandments listed in the Torah, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, etc. And you also, according to the Pauline epistles, you would have to become circumcised. Pardon me, the word escaped my mind for a moment there. So not a lot of adults were willing to, you know, whip it out and have their foreskin taken, you know, while an adult when you're fully conscious and there wasn't great medication back then, right? So people weren't lining up the door to have strange food customs to foreigners. It would be strange Jewish kosher law, especially near the Roman Empire where things were kind of lax in food. They didn't want to become circumcised. In the Roman world, all the religions were really about just pleasing God so you could have a nice life. It wasn't really for planning for the afterlife or doing anything. There wasn't prescriptions you had to do daily in many of the Roman religions of the time that surrounded Judaism. But Judaism was about doing something. You had to actually work to please God. And Paul said, well, you know, don't do what James is doing. You don't have to follow the Torah. You don't need to be circumcised. You don't need to follow special food laws. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is believe in Jesus Christ, that he died, rose from the dead, and that he is your Savior. If you just say this with your lips and believe it in your heart, you're saved. And that's very different from what Jesus actually taught. Very different. So as Pauline churches grew, which became the orthodoxy, Mark and the other subsequent gospels took the oral teachings of Jesus and wrote them down in Greek for the Roman and Gentile audiences out of context to the original Hebrew-Aramaic intentions. Jesus' teachings became grossly distorted because the Greek writers did not utilize the Aramaic Hebrew vocabulary and its intended meanings in the oral tradition of Jesus. Non-biased biblical scholars have taken the Hebrew Bible, written in Hebrew, obviously, and the vast written material about the traditions of the Hebrew Bible, such as the Talmud, which is the Jerusalem version and other versions of the Talmud and other sacred writings, Haggadah, etc. And they took all this information from the Hebrew Bible and its sub-scriptures, if you will, and they knew that this is what Jesus would have studied and taught from, in addition to some intertestamental literature like the Book of Enoch, which is mentioned in the letter of Jude. It's an intertestamental book, which is very important because it talks about what the Son of Man is. And it talks about the fact that the Son of Man, Messiah, is a collective Messiah. That yes, Jesus was a Messiah, but he wasn't the only Messiah. He was the firstborn of the Son of Mankind, collective, anointed, new humanity. This could be known as the communion of saints. And there were many different messianic expectations in the day of Jesus. And most predominantly in Judea was the idea of the Messiah Ben David, which Jesus very satirically remarks about later on in Mark. Biblical scholars then developed the science of biblical criticism to create a lexicon of Hebrew-Aramaic terms and their meaning, or multiple meanings in many cases. With this understanding, we can roll back the English translation of the Christian Testament to get to the Greek, and finally back to the original Hebrew-Aramaic thought world of the Master Jesus. Of course, those original Hebrew-Aramaic words were linked to Jewish idioms, customs, beliefs, and teachings, which add profound depth and beauty to Jesus' teaching, but which are lost to the vast majority of modern Christians. So in Mark, it's very obvious that something is missing as compared to all their canonical gospels. There's no virgin birth. There's no virgin birth in Mark. Well, that's a pretty big detail to miss. And why? Because Jesus was born like everybody else. Sorry, and I know there's going to be some gasps and some people leave and some people will leave the YouTube channel where this will be posted after the Liturgy of the Chalice is done today. But it's just a fact. Paul never mentioned a virgin birth. The writer of the Gospel of Mark didn't mention a virgin birth. It wasn't until 80, 90 years after the crucifixion event that we started to hear about a virgin birth. And that Jesus started to become called or known as God himself. Almost a century after Jesus died, those things started to become released in various scriptures and church writings. But it was a later development. So here in Mark, we have no story of a virgin birth, no mention of any childhood antics of Jesus. We just see it starts with Jesus' baptism by John the Baptist. And we see this in Mark 1, 1 through 5. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.'" John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. So, the very first line says Jesus Christ, the Son of God. No doubt people called Jesus the Son of God, but in the Greek-Roman world, remembering that Mark was written by a Greek-speaking, Greek-writing person or persons, the Son of God, when they hear that, they think literally that God inseminated a woman and voila, there was Jesus. Because in Roman religions, many gods, Roman and Greek religions, many gods copulated with women and produced babies. So for a Greek-Roman thinker, that's the natural conclusion to draw. However, it's well known in Judaism that whenever a sage or a great rav, a rav is a Jewish master, and rav is like the preterm for what would become rabbi after the collapse of the Second Temple in 70 AD. But all throughout Judaism, the term Son of God is a title for a saint. So to call Jesus Christ the Son of God, that meant Jesus, great saint, great tzaddik. Tzaddik means perfected one. And here, Mark doesn't try to link Jesus as being the literal Son of God. He just says he's the Son of God. So perhaps the writer or writers of Mark did understand the Jewish idiom. But if they did, they didn't expand upon the thought. And if they thought that Jesus was literally God, then they didn't expand upon that either. So it's my understanding that they probably thought of Jesus as the Son of God, meaning a perfected or purified saint of God. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness. Why was he in the wilderness? Why wouldn't he be in the streets of Jerusalem preaching where there are larger crowds? And that's because throughout all of Jewish history, the prophets were anti-temple. They were anti-temple establishment. In other words, the people that wanted to use religion to control people, the prophets protested many times throughout the Hebrew Testament. And John was such a one. He despised the temple that was built by the Herods. And ultimately, the Herods decapitated John and killed him, made him a martyr. So the reason why John appeared in the wilderness and not in the city was simply because in the wilderness, he had more freedom to hide from the Herodians and from the temple establishment that would want to execute him. And ultimately, they did execute him. His head was chopped off and handed to Herodias on a plate. So that's why he was in the wilderness, because he would have been much easier. It would have been much easier to arrest and execute him if he preached in the cities where there were lots of soldiers and also Jewish law enforcement, etc. and spies from the Herods, spies from the temple establishment. So that's why he went into the wilderness. And he proclaimed a baptism of repentance. In Judaism, when you don't follow the mitzvah, the commandments of God, when you don't follow Torah, that is considered a sin, a mistake. And by not following the commandments, by not doing the commandments of God that are found in the Torah, then there becomes a separation, so to speak, between the soul and God. And it's a temporary separation that can be resolved. And that's what John was doing through baptism. It was a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. And the idea of repentance is encapsulated in the Hebrew term naham. Naham means submission. You're going to submit to God and shuv, return to God, or return to the way of God outlined in the Torah. That's what John the Baptist wanted, and Jesus did teach that subsequently. So the goal of being baptized was to repent, to reflect on how we do not focus on God or give God priority in our lives. It's saying, I am going to purify myself with this water of baptism. I'm going to purify my mind, my heart. That is what baptism cleans. And then I'm going to focus on submitting to God, lovingly, willingly submitting to God, so that I can make teshuvah, which means a return to God, a return to the way of God. I'm going to do the commandments that purify my heart and create divine union with God, within and without. So that's why John baptized in the wilderness. He was doing something very special. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all people of Jerusalem were going out to see him. So he was getting the people of the city that were the intellectuals, and he was getting the people from the countryside. All people flocked to him. But the whole Judean countryside went to see him. And this is the Amma Ha'aretz, which are the people of the land, which the Jewish temple establishment kind of looked down on these people. And John the Baptist brought those people, as well as the people of Jerusalem that were more educated, etc., to this teaching that, hey, we need to stop sinning. We need to focus on doing what it says in the Torah. And all the mistakes we've made in the past, I'm washing away with this baptism. And now you only have to go forward and do the Torah. And this confession of sin, this repentance to God, is what makes one righteous. It's what makes one right with God, so they can then deepen their relationship with God and even attain mystical union with God. So it's very important to note that probably, you notice that John is not saying this thing about from the prophet of Isaiah. See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. The writer of Mark is saying that this verse from Isaiah in the Hebrew Testament is specifically about John the Baptist and about Jesus Christ. That is not true. Not true. So this what we see in Mark 1:2, which is the recapitulation of this saying of Isaiah. It's from Isaiah 43. It is very important to understand that Jewish prophecy was for the people of that time, not some future time. Jewish prophets were used by God to speak to the people of the time of that particular prophet to help them to return to God, to submit, have naham towards God. They never spoke about some future time. It was a message received by the prophet from God for the people of that prophet's time. So often, verses from the Hebrew Bible are cherry-picked to be about Jesus, or to prove that Jesus is something throughout the canonical Gospels. However, it's just not the case. Here, you know, it gets very confusing for people that don't understand Judaism. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. When you read this, you have no Jewish context as to what Isaiah 43 meant. You would think, as a Christian that's being indoctrinated with Christianity, that I am sending my messenger ahead of you, that messenger would be John the Baptist, to prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare your way of the Lord, Jesus, make his path straight. But that's not what Isaiah was talking about. Isaiah said he was receiving the words of God. God was speaking to Isaiah, and these are the words of God that are misconstrued. God is saying to Isaiah, see, I, God, Yahweh, am sending my messenger, you, Isaiah, ahead of all of Israel. And you'll prepare the way, you'll be a voice crying out in the wilderness, in the desert, prepare the way of Yahweh, the Lord, not Jesus. Make his path straight. Do the Torah. So, this prophecy of Isaiah was post-exilic. It's bringing people out of exile, out of the Babylonian exile, and back to Jerusalem, where they would eventually build the second temple. So, see, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. So God is saying, see, I, God, am sending Isaiah ahead of all the Jewish people, and he'll prepare the way and be a voice crying out in the wilderness, that voice that's saying, come back to God, love God, do this, make yourself right with God. Prepare the way of Yahweh, make his path straight. To move straight towards God means to do the Torah. And that is the original meaning of these verses from Isaiah that were twisted to make us believe that they were specifically about John the Baptist preceding Jesus in this message that would change the world. And although John the Baptist and Jesus are exceptionally special spiritual personages, neither of them were written about in Isaiah. Why did the early Christians cherry-pick Hebrew Testament information, verses? I mean, even Paul, just read the Pauline epistles, and he says, ignore the Torah. Ignore the Torah, just believe in Jesus Christ. That's all you gotta do. Nothing else. Don't do anything else. Just believe. But here, in Mark, they're not listening to what Paul said, even though they take on certain Pauline beliefs as you go through the gospel. But they're actually quoting Hebrew Testament scripture and saying it's about Jesus. Why? Because at that time, Christianity was a struggling new religion. They wanted to use the antiquity of Judaism as a base of authenticity for their new religion that they were developing at the time. So they took Hebrew verses out of context and made them about Jesus. And that's what Mark is insinuating here in 1:2. John the Baptist's humility? That's a question mark. And I'm not saying he wasn't humble, but is he humble in the way that we're taught as Christians to believe? Mark 1:7-8, he proclaimed, John proclaimed, the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. We have to understand that John the Baptist was one of the most great saints of all time, of all religions, in bringing people back to God. Even Jesus says in other canonical scriptures, of all the people born of woman, John the Baptist is the great. And when Jesus says that, he is bowing down to John the Baptist. He's revering John the Baptist because he said that everybody born of a woman, and Jesus was born of a woman no matter how you think of his birth or origin story. Everybody out of all men born of women, including myself, there is nobody greater than John the Baptist. So Jesus was bowing down metaphorically to John, the greatness of John. And here, John is saying, the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. So it's showing here that he's bowing down to Jesus. One way of looking at this is that early Christians knew how famous John the Baptist was, and he became the center of the Manichaean religion. He is the Messiah of the Manichaean religion. So a lot of people thought John the Baptist was the Messiah. John the Baptist was a Messiah. And that's where Christians get confused. The Christians are taught to believe that there's only one Messiah. It was Jesus Christ. But the Jews expected many different kinds of Messiah. Not just one kind. Not all Jews believe the same way. And Jews were allowed to have different messianic expectations without being demonized. So, one thing is that this verse, the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me, and I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. It could be that the early church wanted to make Jesus bigger than John the Baptist. They wanted to make Jesus better, more evolved. But the fact is that Jesus was the student of John the Baptist. Jesus was a disciple of John the Baptist. Whenever you took baptism and you wanted to return to the way, you would then follow the holiness of that teacher. So Jesus became baptized by John, and then he learned from John certain things. And certain things Jesus taught differently than John, which is evident and we'll talk about in the future. But Jesus revered John. And no doubt, John, being such a great sage and illumined being, he saw the greatness of Jesus. So perhaps he did see that Jesus' potential was to outgrow his own spiritual stature. So maybe he did say that in true humility. It depends on which one you want to think about. And then John says, I baptize with water, symbolizing purification of the soul, but he, Jesus, will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The term here is Ruach. The term Holy Spirit is Ruach, which is a fiery energy. Ruach is a feminine word referring to the divine feminine aspect of the one God. Prophets throughout ancient Judaism sought to commune with the Ruach, Holy Spirit, mother aspect of God, who tested her disciple harshly before accepting him or her lovingly. Jesus referred to Ruach as the Ruach HaKodesh. She is Sophia, or Chokmah, of the Hebrew Testament, both names referring to divine wisdom. So, John here is saying that I baptize you with water and encourage you to return to the ways of the Torah. But Jesus is so great that he He baptizes you with the fiery spirit of Ruach HaKodesh. And when one is baptized with Ruach HaKodesh, that perfects a being. It illumines a being, and it makes him or her eligible for spiritual rebirth or spiritual regeneration into the Son of Man, collective, anointed humanity, the communion of saints. Only wisdom ultimately purifies the mind and makes it one with God consciousness. And Jesus was powerful enough spiritually to give that to sincere disciples that were dedicated to his teachings, dedicated to doing his teachings. Not just saying, Lord, Lord, I believe in you, but they actually do what he taught. And how many of us actually do what he taught? If we want to become spiritually regenerated beings, if we want to join the collective Messiah, then we must do the teachings of Jesus and the Torah. John was an exalted sage. In fact, he was the reincarnation of Elijah. Many modern Christians don't believe in reincarnation, but it's plain throughout the Hebrew Testament, and especially in the Christian Testament, it's even more marked. So in Mark, we only find 8:28. Jesus says, who do they say I am? And then Peter says, well, some say that they think that you're John the Baptist, or some say that they think you're Elijah. Which in any extent, Elijah lived long ago. So if they thought Jesus was Elijah, that means that Jesus would have to be reincarnation of Elijah, right? The reincarnation of Elijah. So it's evident that at that time, many Jews believed in reincarnation. And according to Matthew 11:14, Jesus expands upon what he says in Mark 8:28. Matthew 11:14 says, truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets in the law prophesied until John came, and if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. He is Elijah who is to come. Let anyone with ears listen. I do have a misprint on this screen. I'm not sure what, right before this whole talk, in the scene of the baptism of Jesus by John, people ask John, are you Elijah? And Matthew. And John says, no, I'm not Elijah. Why? So in the same gospel, John says he's not Elijah, but Matthew 11:14, Jesus is saying he definitely was Elijah. And that is John's humility. John was a fully illumined being, and he knew who and what he was. He simply did not say it, probably because he didn't want to cause a stir, a riot amongst the people. Why is this important historically? What is not being taught to us by Christian orthodoxy? And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. So many Jews thought that the Messiah would be a reincarnation of Elijah. That Elijah, he went up to heaven in a chariot. He was fully assumed into heaven in the Hebrew Testament. And many Jews had a messianic expectation of Elijah being the Messiah who would come again in the form of another saint. So Jesus is saying that John the Baptist is Elijah, this messianic expectation come to life, teaching all of us. So it's apparent that Jesus, if we accept this as a probable, as if we accept this as a probable historical teaching of Jesus, then it's apparent that Jesus too believed in different messianic expectations. Jesus was baptized by John, Mark 1, 9 through 12. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit, Ruach, descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit, Ruach, immediately drove him out into the wilderness. So, of course, Orthodoxy doesn't like to hear this, but many early Christians and different Gnostic sects believe that this is when Jesus was adopted by God, so to speak. Jesus had purified himself, was willing to fully walk the way, and in that moment where Jesus accepted God, God accepted Jesus. And perhaps some divine power flooded into Jesus for his mission that he would become impassioned about. So a lot of people will interpret this as God adopting Jesus as his son. Others will take this literally. Bible literalists, God, a voice from heaven, it must be God. "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." Does that mean that Jesus is God's literal son, that God inseminated a woman, and that Jesus is a demigod or God itself? That's another interpretation that people have made. For me, a voice came from heaven. That's one's personal intuition. "You are my son, the beloved. With you I'm well pleased." In my opinion, this was an intuitive message that was received by Jesus within his consciousness, in which Jesus felt accepted by God, empowered by God to do his mission. And in reality, we are all sons and daughters of God. God is the one parent of all. But yet there is a difference between absolute God and our souls, which are like cells in the one body of God. We are temples of Ruach, the Holy Spirit. And also, if you're just to read this directly, it's not God the Father saying this. The Spirit, Ruach, is a feminine term. It's the Divine Mother aspect of God. So, who, if the Spirit is descending down upon Jesus like a dove from heaven, and a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my son," it's actually the mother aspect of God that's saying this, if we were to take this literally. And the Spirit, the Divine Mother, immediately drove him out into the wilderness. Now, of course, Judaism was monotheistic. It's one of the only monotheistic religions of that time in that area. In fact, originally it was the only monotheistic religion prior to Christianity and Islam. All the Roman religions that surrounded Judaism worshipped multiple gods. The Jews, at least at a certain point of time, only worshipped one God, which they called Yahweh. But it was always known throughout the Hebrew Testament that there is a female aspect of that one God, and that is Ruach. Jesus called the Ruach HaKodesh. It's also called Hokma in Sophia. What is the sacrament of baptism in our tradition? Which is the home temple tradition that I come from, which is the Church of Saint Philip. For us, baptism is not a forgiveness of sin, original sin or otherwise. Baptism is not the same as spiritual rebirth either, which is a higher initiation given by Jesus then and now. Baptism, then and now, through our church, in the earliest sense of the word that John gave, and what we do presently in our church, represents a soul's longing to return to God in the way of God, represented in the Hebrew Testament and the probable historical teachings of Jesus, found in the Christian Testament and other non-canonical but valid sources. Baptism is a rite marking the beginning of one sincere, dedicated study and doing of Jesus' halakhah teachings. Spiritual regeneration or rebirth into the Son of Mankind, collective Messiah, is the result of embodying and profoundly living the halakhah of the Master Jesus. We'll continue next week with the Gospel of Mark. Let's continue with the Liturgy of the Chalice.